Joshua chapter 2. Make your way to the book of Joshua. We'll say again, very thankful to see those here this morning. Thank you for your faithful attendance. Thank you for your prayers. And look forward to the rest of the day with one another. Sundays are always such an enjoyable day. Joshua chapter 2. Before we read, we'll return to the Lord again in prayer. Dear God, we come to you today very thankful for the many blessings that you've given us. Thankful that you have allowed us to gather together to come to your word. That you have allowed us the time that we might sing and then the capability to sing. That we're just so thankful that you've blessed us in all these areas, that you've gifted us these wonderful songwriters throughout time. That you've gifted those with the ability to play music, given us a great God and a redemption to sing about you and dwell with us, your Holy Spirit, that we might sing in the Spirit genuine songs of praise to you, God, that you've made all these things possible. We thank you for that. We ask you to help us as we look to your word now this morning, that we would be guided of your Spirit and truth, that we'd have an understanding of your word, that we would not take it and twist it, that there would be no mishandling of it, but that we would, with great simplicity, have an understanding of your word, the implications of your word. God, we ask for those here who are lost, that they, through the reading of your word, come to understand your gospel, that they can see that you have really hinged it to all rely upon Jesus Christ. There is nothing then for them to do, nothing for them to have, but it is simply for them to trust on what you have already done and never have. Please help them through the scriptures this morning to see that plainly, see another great picture of that and an example of that. They may come to trust you, be saved. Please help me as I will stand, that I would not do anything of my own accord or of my own will. Lord, please be honored and glorified through the message this morning, whatever way that would look. Please let your church be ministered to, at whatever cost that would come at. And we ask these things in your wonderful holy name, you're so worthy. Amen. Amen. Joshua chapter 2. We begin reading in verse 8. A lengthier reading this morning, but encourage you to follow along. It says, and before they were laid down, she came up unto them upon the roof. She said unto the men, I know that the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror has fallen upon us, and that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. For we have heard how the Lord dried up the water of the Red Sea for you, and you came out of Egypt, and what you did unto the two kings of the Amorites that are on the other side, Jordan, Sihon, and Og, whom you utterly destroyed. And as soon as we heard these things, our hearts did melt, neither did there remain any more courage in any man because of you. For the Lord your God is God in heaven above and in earth beneath. Now therefore I pray you, swear unto me by the Lord, since I have showed you kindness, that you will also show kindness unto my father's house, and give me a true token, and that you will save alive my father and my mother, and my brethren and my sisters, and all they have, and deliver our lives from death. And the men answered her, our life for yours. Ye utter not this our business, and it shall be when the Lord hath given us the land, that we will deal kindly and truly with thee. Then she let them down by a cord, through the window, for her house was upon the wall, upon the town wall, and she dwelt upon the wall. And she said unto them, get ye to the mountain, lest the pursuers meet you, and hide yourselves there 3 days until the pursuers be returned, and afterward may ye go your way. And the men said unto her, we will be blameless of this thine oath, which thou hast made us swear. Behold, when we come into the land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in thy window, which thou didst let us down by. And thou shalt bring thy father, and thy mother, and thy brethren, and thy father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out of thy doors of thy house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head, for we will be guiltless. And whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on our head. If any hand be upon him. And if thou utter this our business, then we will be quit of thine oath, which thou hast made us to swear. And she said, according unto your word, so be it. And she sent them away, and they departed, and she bound the scarlet line in the window. Now we'll stop reading here. Familiar passage of scripture in Joshua chapter 2, this being whenever the spies would come into Jericho, that city with a very great wall. And as the spies were spying this place out before the people of God would get there to overtake it, that they would be caught, that they'd be pursued by the king and the guards of the city. And this harlot, Rahab, that she would take them aside and hide them away from these guards. Hide them on the roof of her house. And of course, that we would be familiar with this account, and that she would kind of make a deal with these folks that since she had done this great act of kindness, that they would spare her life. And there's a little bit more beyond just this deal. The deal was kind of a byproduct of what was actually taking place. And we'll take a look at that a little further in a little bit this morning. But to get our minds going in the right direction, I want us to think of this city, Jericho. That these people in Jericho, that they were quite horrified. That by her own confession, she said, what we read there in verse 9, that she said, that I know the Lord hath given you the land, and that your terror has fallen upon us, that all the inhabitants of the land faint because of you. And she brings up some examples in verse 10. She heard that the Lord dried up the Red Sea. She heard what happened to Egypt. She heard what happened to the Amorites. That she has heard that the enemies of God, and that every enemy of God that stood in the way of his people, they were utterly destroyed. It isn't just some sort of like they got beat up pretty bad, but completely and totally annihilated. And this is, God was steamrolling. I think I used the example in our Friday night study when we come to Joshua, that the book of Joshua can really be summarized by a simple sentence, and that is that the Lord steamrolled everybody in the promised land. And that's kind of what we find in Joshua, that there weren't very many hiccups. There was the one hiccup that comes to mind with Ai, as they would go, and that the man would take of the cloak here in Jericho, and that they would be cursed for that, and then they would go down and get beat. But then after the sin in the camp was addressed, that really beyond that, that there wasn't even... I don't think this was actually the case, but the way that the words were written, it looks like the children of Israel didn't even break a sweat. I'm sure as they were carrying their stuff, it got a little hot and they sweat a little bit. So they got a little tired at night from time to time. From the way it was written, it just wasn't that hard. God just steamrolled absolutely everybody that was in the way. And so this woman, Rahab, and not just her, but the city, the whole city, looking at that, they see... these people are not to be trifled with. These people are to be taken seriously. To get it in our minds also, the picture that's kind of a little bit ridiculous without the proof of the pudding. That these people were a bunch of slaves that were in the wilderness for 40 years. And so for them to just come up to this great city outside the wall, really, normally there wouldn't be much to fear. Kind of just some nomads. And this is a period in history in which that there were plenty of nomadic people that were just kind of wandering around, just a handful of folks. And most folks weren't really scared of them. That really wasn't the issue. It was the Egypts and the Amorites and those folks that they would strike fear. Now, for the city of Jericho to look out and see the Egyptian army coming, well, then, you know, that would make sense for them to shut down. But because of what God had done, he had clearly demonstrated that he meant business. The enemies of God do not stand a chance before God, and they never have. That it's not just these examples. We know what happened as you get to the sixth chapter of the book of Joshua. Jericho was destroyed. That we know what happens as you continue to read, that they were all destroyed, that the people of God overcome all these great odds. That as you go to the period of the judges, you see several enemies that come up here and there. The Philistines gave them great affliction because the Lord allowed them to. But whenever the Lord chose to deliver them, he delivered them. We looked in Sunday school this morning at Samson, and how that Samson slew tens of thousands all at one time. That is kind of what the Lord does to his enemies. He destroys them. And for you here who are lost, that as you very well know, I make this statement all the time, that you are God's enemy. That you have made yourselves to be his enemy in every way. At one point in my life, that I was the enemy of God, that we are born God's enemy. And I want to take a moment to explain what I mean by that, because as you sit there, that for us, the enemies of God are those that are out this morning, that the enemies of God this morning, and I don't mean this too literally, don't think I'm being overly harsh, but you know, the enemies of God are those people you pass by this morning that were pulling their boat down to the river. Those are God's enemies. They don't care nothing for him. The enemies of God, those are those people that we'll see in the newspaper. Those are the people that are doing this or doing that. Those are God's enemy. I'm here this morning, so I'm not God's enemy. Well, that's not necessarily true. And for those of you who are here and redeemed, that those of you who are here and have trusted in Christ, You are not God's enemy, and you never will be again. Praise the Lord for that. But if you've never trusted in Christ, you're the enemy of God. And that may seem as though that it is very harsh, because that there are plenty of folks that, to be quite honest with you, as a kid, as far as kids go, I was a pretty good kid. I didn't need a whole lot of whippings. I remember getting just two or three of them, and I, as a young child, I thought to myself, I didn't like that. I'm going to stop doing the things that gets me whipped. And that was just kind of the mentality I had. And so whenever I was told to do something, I would do it. My grandma ensured that I was in church on Sunday morning, that we'd go stay at her house on Saturday night, and I would be in Sunday school, and I would be in, we would get there late, but I would be in Sunday school eventually, or like every Sunday morning. I joke that I did not realize Sochter sang a song before Sunday school until I was about 13 years old. We just got there and went right on to class, but I was there. She made sure I was there. That I tried to be a good kid, that there were certainly times in which I failed to do so. There was times that I was immature. But I tried to be a good kid, and at the moment that I realized I was lost, I was sure enough God's enemy and his greatest enemy. Despite my efforts in trying to do things the right way, despite trying to be obedient, despite trying to do all of that, that I was still God's enemy. And it was kind of hard to wrap my mind around, but as we look to the nature of sin in Scripture and the depiction of it, it makes sense that if you are lost, that you are God's enemy. And so we'll do that momentarily. Turn to Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. Read just a couple of verses here, beginning in verse 12. Romans 5 and verse 12. Romans chapter 5 and verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For to the law sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. Let's stop reading the verse 14. That there is this showing of sin and what, just how rampant sin is in the world. That we would know that it starts out in verse 12 that sin entered into the world by one man. And there are consequences to that sin. You would recall in the book of Genesis, right out the gate, chapter 3 comes along, and that the serpent would come, Satan, he would come and he would tempt Eve, and Eve would eat of the forbidden fruit. For that fruit of the knowledge of good and evil, that which God had commanded, that's the one fruit that they were not to eat of. And she would pass that to Adam, and Adam having received the instruction, Adam being the one responsible, ate of the fruit, Adam would bring this sin into the world. And that as the Lord would come, that after that, he warned Adam from the get-go, that the day ye eat thereof, ye shall surely die. And there is a death that is to take place. There is a separation. That's really what death is. That in the physical sense, our death is a separation from life. And that is what is going to happen because of sin, that we must die in the flesh so long as the Lord delays his coming. But that there is a separation spiritually, that there is a death that Adam experienced to which the Lord would no longer come in the cool of the day to talk with him. That he would no longer be permitted to be in the presence of God. As a matter of fact, he would no longer be permitted to be in the Garden of Eden. There was a separation. He was cut off because of his sin, and it brought this fallen nature to him. And that nature, everyone born of through the seed of man, is a sinner. That every single one, that's why Christ couldn't be born of the seed of man. He was born of God and a woman. That everyone of the direct lineage, that everyone born of man, inherits this fallen nature. That this original sin, it came by way of choice. But we see that that's not the only way that we're concluded a sinner. It says in verse 13, for until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression. that what this is getting at is that there is a stretch of period or a period of time between this man Adam and the man Moses. And with Moses came the law. It came where God wrote his commandments down. That he penned them that for all the world to see that those commandments are written. Here's what God expects. Here's what holiness looks like. But it says that sin was in the world and that death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned in the same manner that Adam did. You see, Adam sinned because he had received a commandment. Adam was told not to do something. And then everybody between Adam and Moses, that they didn't receive that commandment directly from God as Adam had. Nevertheless, they were still sinful. There was still the warning of what God had commanded. There was still a precedence that was set. There was still expectations. There was the law of God written in man's heart. That's why they have a conscience. That's why all around the world, that no society, to my knowledge, on the face of the planet, is it okay to go and murder somebody. That's just not acceptable. There is a law written on our hearts that tell us this. And so that they are sinning against this, and so death continued to reign, that we inherit this nature. But then the law did come. That this law came by way of Moses, and God told us expressly, this is what I expect. God tells us directly, pinned, that to lie is to sin against the Lord. He would tell us to not commit adultery, to not covet. He would tell us specifically, this is what he expects. Have no other gods before me. He would tell them the greatest commandment, according to Jesus, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And he would tell us these things, and so we know them. It's not just that they're written in our heart. It's not a matter that we could try to plead ignorance, even though we couldn't. But they are plainly revealed. And so as we sit here today, and we can even fast forward beyond Moses, that we have the rest of the Old Testament, we have the completion of the New Testament, we have since the time of the early church that God had worked through the Holy Spirit to compile his scriptures, that there is never today that there is the most available the Word of God has ever been throughout all of time, that it is freely available to nearly every single soul on the face of this planet. And for you this morning, you have more accountability probably than anyone else that has ever been born of the access that you have to God's Word, the access that you have to public education. That's a pretty new thing. It's a pretty new thing that almost everybody knows how to read within this society. As a matter of fact, some of our grandparents and great-grandparents didn't know how to read. This is a very new thing. You have been given all the resources. You have been blessed abundantly to know right and wrong, to know the expectations of God, and to know the gospel. And so you're told these things. And for you, where you sit right now, that there is a time in which you have told a lie. If you say otherwise, there's your first one. Or I guess your second one. That there is a time in which you have deliberately chosen to lie. That you sat there and you said, well, I know all that's a lie. And you do it anyways. This is kind of what happens. It's by our nature. There's a time that you have probably taken something that was not yours. My mind, speaking of innocence, my youngest brother, still in a car seat, as young as he could be, he wanted a candy bar from the Dollar General in Socher. And my mom told him no. And we got in the car, and he had the heart of rebellion and the mind of a moron. You wouldn't buy this for me, so I stole it. He didn't even try to eat it in quiet. He brought it. You wouldn't buy this for me, so I took it. That's what he said. That's stealing. That's against the Word of God. There's a time in which you are guilty of something, maybe not to that degree, maybe not that silly. There's a time in which you've taken something that didn't belong to you. There are times, and you can go back directly in your mind. There are times you've probably committed adultery in your heart. There are times that you can go back and see the commandments and recall a specific moment, a specific time that you have sinned. And so, what's the big deal? I thought God forgives. I thought God was merciful. All these, well, he is. But for you to do that and to have no repentance, for you to do that and there be no consequences paid, then that's a pretty big deal. that God wrote these things for a reason. God's laws are not arbitrary. His commandments aren't for no use. They are good and they are righteous. They are pure. And God is the creator of all things. He made you. You had no shot of existing in this world had God chosen not to let you. That there is this kind of this thought that we have within ourselves of, well, who is God to tell me what to do? He's the one that allowed you to breathe. He's the one that allowed you to be here. And so he's the one, him. He has the right to do that. This is his world. He created it. He made it. He set the precedent. You were created to fulfill a role, and you can complain all you want to about it, but that doesn't make any sense. The Lord had every right as sovereign and good. He created you for the most honorable role that has ever been created. That he created all, he created the animals. The animals don't serve that honorable role. He created the angels. They serve a very honorable role, but yours is more honorable. He made you in God's own image. He didn't make the angels in God's image. He made you as this vessel of free will that you might worship the Lord. And he gave you the instructions on how to do it. And you haven't. You've chosen not to. And that's a very big deal. I want to tell you why this is a big deal. I just had a conversation Friday about this very same thing. For those of you that have young children, or those of you that are married or dated or had friends or anything, really in any relationship, for somebody to come and just demand something and to ask something, that's two very different things. If your child came to you in the grocery store and say, hey, can I have this candy bar? You might say no, but you're more inclined to say yes than if they come to you and say, hey, buy me this candy bar. It's not only am I not buying it, now you're getting whipped. That's kind of how that goes. There's a big difference there. Because they have a role. They have a place in subjection to you. They're in subjection to your authority. And that matters. You can't set a precedence that they can break that line of authority. For you to give in to that, that teaches them that they can just go ahead, that maybe they do have a false sense of authority now that you would allow them to have. And so us before God, we have no such authority. We have no ability to do this. And so God has told us to do something. He's commanded it. And if we don't do it, then God is unjust to allow that to go on. What happens in our rebellion, it may be what feels like an innocent thing. That whenever you were told to go take the trash out as a kid and you were going to get around to it and you just didn't really feel like it right now and then you forgot or, you know, whatever. There's some long list of excuses, but you disobeyed. And that disobedience is no good. Really what it boils down to is that there is a deliberate choice. I'm told to do something. I know to do it. And I'm choosing not to do it. That's what sin boils down to. Every single sin. I've made the statement before, and I still stand by it, that every single sin is a matter, an issue of pride. Every one of them. Every time. Every time you tell a lie, you know not to do it. But you say, I'm going to anyways. There is a war. Not that God is waging against you, that you are waging against God. That's the issue of sin. And so to be guilty of such a thing, you're choosing sin over what God rightfully created you to do. And I want you to notice, this is the exact thing that Satan did. To sin, when we think of the enemies of God, Satan, number one enemy. But what you are doing is putting yourself in Satan's literal shoes. What was Satan's sin? That he wanted to take the place of God. God created him for a purpose, and he said, I don't want to fulfill that purpose. I want to be like God. That was even the temptation that he gave to Eve. He would tell Eve that if the day you eat of this fruit, that you will be, that the Lord, he lied to you. He just doesn't want you to eat it because you will be like unto the gods, knowing good and evil. You'll be like him. You'll rival him. That's what preyed on the heart of Eve. That's what enticed her. And so that is what Satan did. Satan saw the throne of God and wanted to ascend the throne of God. He wanted to be the one calling the shots. And we've already established that's the very thing you choose to do when you sin. You want to call the shots. God told you not to lie, but dadgum it, I want to lie, so I'm going to. He waged that war. And so it is right for you to be the enemy of God. It makes sense you're the enemy of God. And being God's enemy, you start to look at the track record of God's enemies. This takes us back to Joshua. We look to the track record of what has happened to God's enemies. We look at, for example, what happened to Egypt. And in Egypt's situation, that they clearly took the form of God's enemy, they were pursuing God's people very aggressively, trying to kill them. They were really exerting themselves and very aggressive towards God. That we can think of plenty like this today, those that are at war with God, not just those that are indifferent towards Him, but those that are actively persecuting the church, those who are actively removing God's word and just trying to destroy it, that all throughout history this has been taking place. And we can certainly think of these kind of that mentality, the very same mentality that the Egyptians had. We say, well, I don't have that mentality. But nevertheless, we look at what God did to His enemies there. That as you go to the Song of Moses, I want to say it's Exodus 12 or 15, somewhere in there. I could be completely wrong. But that He would praise the Lord for His horse and His rider had He thrown into the sea. That He had destroyed the entire army, Pharaoh included, by being His enemy, by pursuing and waging that war against God. And so those in Jericho heard of this, and they were afraid. As a matter of fact, just to read you one more verse of their fear in Joshua chapter 6 and verse 1. I'm just reading the one verse here. It says, now Jericho was strictly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. They shut down every operation of their fear. They had good reason to be afraid. The people in Jericho thought, we are not as big and strong as Egypt was, and they didn't stand a chance. The great Amorite kings, that was another one that she mentioned, as Sihon and Og. And in our Friday night study, if I'm not mistaken, we took a brief look at these kings. That was actually a really big deal. These people, like through secular history, are very impressive, very, very highly regarded. There are many, if I'm not mistaken, that there are like written documents of that time speaking of I can't remember which one of these, but one of these men, I want to say it was Og, this king, having just a gigantic bed, just being this gigantic man, just huge. That this was kind of a very big deal. And so in their case, they weren't like the Egyptians. They weren't necessarily pursuing God's people relentlessly, hunting them down. But they felt like they were being encroached upon, that God's people was coming by their way, and they weren't too pleased with that. They weren't happy with that, and they felt threatened by God. And certainly we could think of some that are this way, maybe not quite as aggressive, but certainly feel threatened and kind of lash out at God. And yet, the people of Jericho, they weren't that way. They hid. These people of Jericho, they built a big wall, and they hid. They didn't go and try to fight. They didn't go and meet them halfway. They shut everything down, and they hid. And that sometimes is what God's enemies do as well. They may not necessarily act aggressively, like in Rahab's examples, but they hide. Looking, I think that would probably apply to just about most folks who are here and lost. Maybe not all. Maybe some of y'all probably wouldn't really fit the, I don't think anybody here would fit the Egyptian example. At least I certainly pray not. But some of you may kind of lash out at God and kind of actively and with angst fight against Him. But I believe probably most of y'all here who are saved probably fit more in the category of hiding away in terror, holding your guard up constantly against God. And the way this looks, that we can come across it several different ways, but I think of me as I was lost, that there was just always some sort of hang-up between me and the Lord, that I just never could quite trust Him. And normally that was me analyzing myself, that perhaps that I just didn't think that my prayer was quite impressive enough. I know I've shared this with you, but I put a lot of emphasis on how good my prayer was and make sure I was saying all the exact right words. And so I wanted to make sure it was all in its proper place. And my guard was just up with the Lord, that there was just, in my mind, there was no way I could trust Him to save me unless I prayed just right. And so that I would have my guard up, that there was that preventing me from really just relying upon Him, from being totally submissive to Him. To succumb to His will. I couldn't do it. I had my guard. I could. I was choosing not to. I want to change my wording there. I was choosing not to. That to have your guard up against the Lord, it doesn't work. It will never work. We find plenty that try to do this, and in no situation does it ever work. My mind goes to probably a couple months ago now, there was a stretch of time that we just kept on going back to Isaiah. And we kept on going back to that example. And I think it's in chapter 28. It was also Brother Etienne from up in Canada come down and had a youth sing and did a devotion on the very same scriptures, and we've just been looking at them. That time in which that Israel, that they would make a covenant with death. That they would more or less say things are going to work themselves out. That they would go into Egypt, that they were going in all these different areas and putting their guard up. They were scared. And they would go to Egypt and try to make an alliance with them. To that way they could kind of breathe a little bit. They would go into all these other places and try things all on their own. And the Lord's saying, you're making this covenant with death. You're going out and raising your guard up. You're trying to protect yourself. What was going to happen is judgment is coming, and when it does, it will be an overflowing scourge. That's how he pronounces it. Or that's how he describes it. And then he would say that the bed is not big enough for you to stretch yourself out on. Your covers are not big enough for you to cover yourself up with. That is not good enough. You go on to the 59th chapter of Isaiah. That it gives a depiction there of and this is going to sound weird, but just give me a moment, it'll make sense. Of a cockatrice and of a spider's web. That's the two examples it uses. And a cockatrice, for those that don't know, it's kind of an old mythological creature. And it, more or less, for simplicity's sake, you think of it as a bird. And you think of that spider that is spinning its webs. That it uses both of these examples. And it very beautifully shows how much that they were trusting in themselves. That if we go, I'm going to turn and read. I tried not to. I tried to get through it without turning, but I just can't. Isaiah 59. Little kids last night in the primary age group would be disappointed in me. I gave them a test on this chapter, and I still got to turn to it. Verse 4. It says, none calleth for justice, nor any pleadeth for truth. They trust in vanity and speak lies. They conceive mischief and bring forth iniquity. They hatch cockatrice eggs and weave the spider's web. He that eateth of their eggs dieth, and that which is crushed breaketh out into a viper. Their webs shall not become garments, neither shall they cover themselves with their words. Their works are works of iniquity, and the act of violence is in their hands. So these two examples, it speaks of hatching an egg. And kind of the depiction is of this bird hatching an egg. It takes time. That they're incubating it and waiting and waiting and waiting and waiting, and eventually what hatches out is something that is harmful to them. As a matter of fact, he then goes on to relate it to a snake's eggs. And kind of the picture would be, if you went and found some, we'll use an example that we're familiar with, you go find some rattlesnake eggs and you hold it in your hand until it hatches, and you hatch it, and that snake comes out. It's not something good for you. As a matter of fact, you'll find out very quickly that snake's going to bite you, and you're very likely to die unless you go get some help. That it is very harmful to you. That's kind of what it's showing. And what the thing that they're hatching is all of their works, that they're building up these works, and they're waiting and waiting and waiting. And what comes out of it is mischief and iniquity. It's that which speaks lies. It then goes on to speak of these spiders spinning webs, and that my mind in the summer walking through the woods, there's always we always call them banana spiders. I know that's not what they are, like gold ward weavers or whatever they're called. Think about taking you off a full wheeler. And you get some of those wrapped around you, boy, it feels like it's all over you. But to try to wear that as a garment, it really wouldn't work out. It would be a whole lot showing. You'd have a hard time covering yourself up with it. That when you think of a web, it's very open. And so them trying to cover themselves with their works, well, it just leaves all these gaps. It leaves all that. It's just not sufficient. If they needed that clothing for anything, for anything at all. They couldn't even cover their nakedness, let alone if it was cold, there would be no protection. You need armor that they would be out of luck. And so that's these that are depending on their works, but their works are iniquity. Their righteousness is as filthy rags, and so it will not work. To build up your guard, as impressive as it may seem, as solid as of a plan as you may think that you have, it won't work. We think of Jericho. Jericho had some big old walls. That was what they trusted in. I think of the Edomites. As a matter of fact, the book of Obadiah, we'll turn and read there. Obadiah, it's only one chapter. It's before Jonah, which is only like four chapters. And after Amos, Amos has nine chapters. It'd be a little something to aim for. Book of Obadiah. In verse, I guess before I read it, I'll give y'all time to turn and kind of explain what's so significant about these verses. The Edomites, they were those that descended from Esau, and their capital city was in a very impressive place. It was, they quite literally, these verses will make sense when we read them, they dwelt in the rocks, that they were in the mountains, and there was very limited ways in and very narrow passages, and it was the Edomites, they weren't a very impressive people, that they weren't some world superpower, but they were left alone because it was such a pain to go take them. They were in such an easily defended place. And so this resulted in them kind of relaxing, them saying, well, look, we dwell in the rocks. We're safe. We're secure. Nobody's going to come overtake us. That they really won't even try. Most folks wouldn't even try. But in verse 1, it says, the vision of Obadiah, thus saith the Lord God concerning Edom, we have heard a rumor from the Lord, and an ambassador is sent among the heathen. Arise ye, and let us rise up against her in battle. Behold, I have made thee small among the heathen. Thou art greatly despised. The pride of thine heart hath deceived thee, thou that dwellest in the clefts of the rock, whose habitation is high, that saith in his heart, who shall bring me down to the ground? But thou exalt thyself as the eagle, and that thou set thy nest among the stars, whence will I bring thee down, saith the Lord. They were very comfortable with what they had built. And the Lord said, I will bring you down. They think that they are eagles. The Lord is going to teach them otherwise. And he did. I want to tell you the extent that he did. I may have shared this with you, but the book of Obadiah for a long time was used to discredit the Bible. Because they were saying these people, that this situation, they just didn't exist. This alleged city, all of these things, they just didn't exist. And that's because the Lord destroyed them so fervently. It took us until the late 18, I think sometime in the 1800s to even find the ruins of this city. There was nowhere that they would look all through this area and just could never even find where this supposed city was supposed to be. The Lord destroyed it to that degree. That he truly brought them down, and he pronounces judgment for the rest of the book here, this one chapter. Maybe we'll get around to studying it one day if we can ever get through Nehemiah. But the Lord would utterly, he would find them out, regardless of how secure that they felt. Think of the book of Revelation. And as you get around about that, I think that 18th chapter of the book of Revelation, it describes Babylon, this new Babylon, this new city. And the Lord destroys it. And when he does, it is like the saddest funeral ever for the people. That's kind of how it's described. It describes Babylon as this woman. And it speaks of all of those that had trusted in its system, all the merchants that made their riches off of this system. They would weep bitterly. All the people that took joy and pleasure in it were distraught. That more or less the whole world built up all of their plans and hopes on this city Babylon, on this new system that was vehemently against God. And the Lord destroyed it. And as it rose up in smoke, the people of God rejoiced, but everybody that built their hope up in it lamented. So, and as we read in continue to think on the book of Revelation, chapter 6, some very famous scriptures of those that would try to hide themselves from the wrath of God. Revelation 6, in verse 15. It says, and the kings of the earth and the great men and the rich men and the chief captains and the mighty men and every bondman and every free man hid themselves in the dens and rocks of the mountains and said unto the mountains and rocks, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne and from the wrath of the Lamb. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? And so then they tried to, just as Jericho did, hide. Just as those Edomites did, they tried to hide. Just as the Israelites did, they tried to hide, but it doesn't work. God finds them out every time. The Israelites taken away into captivity. All those plans that they made, all those alliances that they made didn't work. As a matter of fact, it bit them in the rear end. When you think of, as we've already said in the book of Obadiah, completely destroyed. Here at the end of time, looking forward, that they run and they try to find anywhere that could shield them from the wrath of God, and they say there is no place to hide. This is a prophecy. So I want you to understand the words of Scripture, they're full of prophecy. And they've all come true up to this point, every single one of them. That could be fulfilled by now, will be fulfilled. There's a few left to come, and they have not been disqualified yet. They're going to come to pass. Okay, so we have this prophecy. There are, these words here are kind of words given to you from people at some time in the future whenever the Lord is pronouncing his judgment. And these people are declaring, or that they are running to the rocks and saying, fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sitteth on the throne, from the wrath of the Lamb. And they're saying, for the great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand? And they find none. And so that's their warning from the future. Here's your future warning of what it's going to be like. So heed that warning. God will find you out. There's no hiding. His enemies don't stand a chance. None of them. No tactic. And there are a lot of things to hide behind. For a while, I would hide behind the thought. Here we talk about being saved and being kept safe from the Lord, not coming to that time of accountability. And so there's kind of that hope. Well, you know, maybe I'm just not to that time of accountability. But I understood sin. I understood I was wrong. So I was accountable. But then there's so much to add into to muddy the waters, and we feel really safe in muddy waters. We feel safe in darkness. That's why men love darkness rather than light. But for a moment, sit in the light, however painful it may be, and come to understand there is nothing for you to hide behind. And God will find you. And so what do you have to do? It's not all doom and gloom. Rahab, she made it out okay. She was blessed, as a matter of fact, to be with God's people. And it was not because she did some marvelous work. It wasn't because she hid the spies that God felt that he owed her something. It was none of that. It was the fact that she trusted in the Lord. That she sees God's people. She hears of the account. She knows what this God is capable of, and yet she says, she believes that God will be merciful to her. If she did not believe that, she would not have been despised, I promise. She would have done everything in her ability to keep those people from getting whatever information that they had. She would have gone, the whole city was doing this. That's why it totally shut down. That it just a complete, talking about lockdowns, this was a lockdown. And so if she thought that God would not be merciful to her, there is no, she would have seen those spies and said, guards right here. She may have even hit them on the roof and got the guards and brought them up. She believed the Lord would be merciful to her. Why did she believe this? I don't know. She didn't have a reason to. I mean, she has a reason to. God is merciful. But as far as from her perspective, this, talk about the enemies of God, this was a bottom dweller among the enemy of God. This was a harlot. The people of the city, the people of a unrespectable city, a wicked city, would look down on her. And she's the very, very, very bottom of the barrel we're talking about here. Not even a harlot in Israel. We talk bad enough about Gomer. She seemed at least to be among God's people, if I'm remembering correctly. This was a harlot among God's greatest enemy and the one he was fixing to destroy. And so she didn't have her good works. She didn't have anything. She relied on the fact that she believed that God would be merciful to her. God was merciful to her. Because he is. This is of his character. He's righteous, and he has to execute his wrath. And all these things that we talked about, we spoke of his judgment, he will find you out so long as you refuse to trust the Lord. And he will. And he has to. But he's the God who delights in mercy. And his ear is open to all who cry to him. That she turned from that protection. She didn't rely on Jericho. She didn't rely on the wall. She didn't rely on her king or her nobles or the guards. She turned from all of that stuff that she thought was protecting her and turned to the Lord to protect her. And guess what? There is exactly, well, I was going to say exactly one. That's not true. We don't know the exact number. There is exactly one household, I'll put it that way. I was about to say one soul. However many souls chose to stay in those doors, there is one household in all of Jericho that made it. One. Because there was one household that trusted in the Lord. Every other one, they were found out. They were put to death. Without exception. This is, again, the degree of God's wrath that he would pour out. I love the way it's worded here in Joshua. We come to verse 14 in chapter 2 where we read it. And the guards, not the guards, the spies would answer her, "Our life for yours." That was kind of what she had to go on. That she would plead with the spies, "Whenever you come back, have mercy on this household." And he says, "Our life for yours." In other words, he's saying, if your life is taken, our life is taken. That's the degree of confidence that she had to go on. It goes on down further in verse 18. It says, "Behold, when we come into the land, thou shalt bind this line of scarlet thread in the window, which thou didst let us down by, and thou shalt bring thy father and thy mother and thy brethren and all father's household home unto thee. And it shall be that whosoever shall go out the doors of thy house into the street, his blood shall be upon his head, and we will be guiltless. And whosoever shall be with thee in the house, his blood shall be on our head, if any hand be upon him." That's their guarantee. That by our own life, we guarantee that you will be protected so long as you put this cord, this scarlet cord in your window and you stay in this within these doors, you will be kept safe. It's their guarantee. And it happened. They came to pass. And this is from man's perspective. Man has the capacity of messing up. This is God's promise too. That God has provided a way of salvation through his Son, Jesus Christ. That we'll turn and read Romans chapter 10. This is the last passage of scripture I plan to read this morning, if that's any consolation to you. Romans chapter 10. God has provided his gospel and all the work that is necessary to be saved and made it known to you very publicly. There's nothing secretive about it. There's nothing mystical about it. There's nothing that it's not even a mystery anymore. It used to be a mystery of God's will, but it is now a mystery revealed. Romans chapter 10 and verse 4. It says, "For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. For Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, a man which doeth those things shall live by them. But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring up Christ again the dead. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. For there is no difference between the Jew and the Greek. For the same Lord over all is rich unto all that call upon him. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the process of salvation that God has prepared. We talked about the end of the law for righteousness. We all concluded, like an hour ago almost, that we're guilty of the law. We failed. And so if you're trying to achieve righteousness by the law, it's too late. You can't backtrack. You can't make up ground. So that's not going to happen. I need that to end. I need something different. And so the Lord has provided that. Not the righteousness of the law, but the righteousness of by faith. And he says that this righteousness that is by faith, the word is nigh unto you. It is close. It is nearby. It's not far away. I know that we've looked at these scriptures before, and I've explained this, but I ask you to listen. whenever he says, and he gives some examples of what it is not. He says, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven, that is to bring Christ down from above, or who shall descend into the deep, that is to bring Christ again from the dead. That this is very reminiscent of the scriptures that were given in the book of Deuteronomy when Moses declares the law. And he says, the law of God is nigh unto you. You don't have to go up to the throne room of heaven to receive a special instruction. You don't have to receive a special prophecy and revelation of the Lord for you to understand salvation. You don't have to descend into the realm of the dead to find Christ somewhere. He's not there anyways. You don't have to do any of these spectacular, miraculous, or mystical things to figure out what you need to do to be saved. The word is nigh you, it says. But what saith it? The word is nigh thee, even in thy mouth and in thy heart. That is the word of faith which we preach, that if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. He goes to the two things here. To confess the Lord Jesus and believe in thine heart that he's raised him from the dead. It's an important process. Because your way of salvation depends entirely on the work of Christ. We've already established you have nothing to hope on. But Christ, he's a righteous God. He's the Son of God. He dwelt in human flesh. He lived a perfect life. And he died. He became obedient unto death, being crucified, having God's wrath poured out on him. And he rose from the dead to overcome death and hell. What you couldn't do. So he has done the work. So if you're going to put your trust in anything, it's not in what you have, it is what he has done. And trust in him. So and for those of you here, and I'm going to acknowledge this, because if you're lost and you're struggling with that, you're frustrated by what I just said. Because you've believed that your whole life, probably. Probably raised believing it. Never a time that you didn't believe that. But the one difference is you need to believe that Christ will save you. That's what he's done to save you. That's his work. That's what he's provided the evidence. That's what he's told you he's done. There's a way for you to look and say, oh, that makes sense. That's how God is saving me. It is by his righteousness and by his grace. But you must believe that he will save you. For the scripture saith, whosoever believeth on him shall not be ashamed. When we think of those words that the spies use, our life for yours. And here, that we have this promise, whosoever believes in Christ will never be ashamed. You will never suffer God's wrath. You will never regret. You won't get to the kingdom of heaven and say, Lord, I trusted you to save me and you failed. It's impossible. God would have to fail to be God for that to happen. And that's the way he has lined it up to be. That is how he has planned it out. And that way, I think of that kind of that deal that they came to in Joshua. That he said, if anyone leaves these doors, their life is on their own head. So long as they stay in here, their life is on our head. There was a place to be. I'm talking about a place to hide. It's not in the walls of Jericho, and it's not in the clefts of the rock. It's in the way that God has provided for salvation is in Jesus Christ. That's why it's so important, that study that we're doing in Ephesians chapter 1, that constant repetition is in Christ, in Christ, in Christ, in Christ. Have confidence in all of these things because Jesus Christ would have to fail to be Jesus Christ for you to suffer wrath. Christ would have to fail to be Christ for all his promises to fail. That's why I wanted to sing that song this morning. Standing on the promises of God, that's all that we have to stand on. Not standing, another song that I think of, Rock of Ages, where they would say that, I think it's in that second verse, if I'm not mistaken, in my hand no price I bring, simply to that cross I cling. There's nothing else. She had this scarlet cord, beautiful depiction of the blood of Christ that would be shed, this way of salvation. And they said, so long as you abide by our process, you will be saved. And if you abide by your process, you will die. That is God's instruction to you as well. So long as you trust in Christ, he would have to fail to be God for you to be lost. And so long as you try your way, you are guaranteed to suffer God's wrath. And so God will not fail. He is guaranteed what will work, and it is up to you to trust him. It is up to you to take God at his word. I think of
I won't lie to you, because it's a lengthier reading, and it's time for me to hush. My stomach's growling too. In Job 19, I actually thought about reading most of this chapter today. We won't. But in Job 19, we all are familiar with that passage of Scripture, "I know my Redeemer liveth." And leading up to that verse, that he goes on this very long spiel. He talks about how that... I'm sorry. I gotta read it. It is too beautifully put for me to butcher it. And I could try to summarize it, but it would not be to the same effect of God's word. And so bear with me a little longer. And I did put a stipulation whenever I said the wrong. I said this is the last verse I plan to read. And that was true at the time. We won't read the whole chapter though. Verse 5. In verse 6, so at least I'll be right on the technicality. In verse 6 of Job 19, he's speaking to his friends, and his friends are vexing his soul. And he says, "Know now that God hath overthrown me and hath compassed me with his net. Behold, I cry out for wrong, but I am not heard. I cry aloud, there is no judgment. He hath fenced up my way that I cannot pass. He hath set darkness in my paths. He hath stripped me of my glory and taken the crown from my head. He hath destroyed me on every side. I am gone in my hope. Hath he removed like a tree. He hath also kindled his wrath against me and counted me unto him as one of his enemies. His troops come together and raise up their way against me and encamp round about my tabernacle. He hath put my brethren far from me, and my acquaintance are verily estranged from me. My kinsfolk have failed, and my familiar friends have forgotten me. They that dwell in mine house and my maids count me for a stranger. I'm an alien in their sight. I called my servant, and he gave me no answer. I entreated him with my mouth. My breath is strange to my wife, though I entreated for the children's sake of mine own body. Yea, young children despised me. I arose, and they spake against me. All my inward friends abhorred me, and they whom I loved returned against me. My bone cleaveth to my skin and to my flesh, and I am escaped with the skin of my teeth." We read that depiction, and I think we can all conclude Job was a miserable man. I think we can all conclude that Job felt miserable. As a matter of fact, he would go on to say that he has turned every way he knows to turn, and the Lord doesn't seem to be there. So we think, what is Job's comfort? What is his hope? Because we know what's coming. I know my Redeemer living. It's this powerful verse. Where does he derive that from? Just simply that God told him. God promised it. Otherwise, there's nothing else. He has nothing. This list that we read through, he speaks of his emotional condition. He speaks of his physical condition. He speaks that his wife really has nothing to do with him. His servants don't respect him. His friends have abandoned him. His health is gone. His bone cleaves to his skin and to his flesh. He's escaped with the skin of his teeth. He has nothing. And so what does he have to hope in? Because you who are lost, I've been lost. I know what you're looking for. Something that just jumps out. This big showing of things to indicate to you that everything has worked. What do you actually have to go on? That he would go on to say in verse 25, "For I know that my Redeemer liveth, and that he shall stand at the latter day upon the earth. And though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God." He was promised of God some things. And he said, "I trust in those things, despite what's going on. I know that even though my condition is no good, and my health is gone, I know that even though it seems that the Lord is slaying me and has abandoned me, I know that when this body gets put in the dirt and the worms eat up my skin, that there is coming a day that I'll be resurrected, and in this body I shall see God." And that is what is going to happen. That's the promise. It's our hope and our salvation. What is that hope built on? It's built on Jesus Christ and nothing less. And so for you who are lost, trust in the Lord to redeem you, and let that be sufficient. If it seems overly simplistic,